computing in your pocket, the prehistory of the iPhone in Silicon Valley. Silicon Valley has long been a fertile place for ideas about computing, but it was a late bloomer when it came to handheld computing products. By the mid-1980s, firms in Japan, England, and other places in the United States were already selling first or second generation products, while the Valley stayed primarily focused on PCs. But then, 2 decades before Steve Jobs introduced the iPhone, a handful of local engineers and designers began to dream of going mobile in a big way. In 1987, starting with the then secret Newton project inside Apple, and with a mobile band-based computer at Go Corp, a range of handheld computing ideas began to bubble up all around the Valley. Before long, inside Apple, there were prototypes like Swatch and Pen Mac, and the pocket crystal idea would soon be spun out as General Magic in 1990. Shortly afterwards, in 1992, Palm Computing was founded. The race was on to reinvent computing and make it even more personal. Tonight's program features a panel of people at the heart of that reinvention to moving computing into your pocket. To introduce tonight's speakers, let me share some numbers. Steve Capps, 10 million, the size increase, OS X to the original Mac system, 6+, the number of patents from Newton that Apple cited in iPhone suits. 48, the number of years as a paid programmer. 792 million, the return on Newton's $2.5 million investment in ARM. 0, the number of times Gary Trudeau used a Newton before lampooning it. Please join me in giving a very warm welcome to Steve. He's the chief innovator at PayNearMe, as well as a member of the Apple Newton design team. Steve, glad to have you here.
Thank you.
Donna Dubinsky, 1 million, the number of Palm Pilots sold in the first 18 months. 38, the number of patents received at Numenta so far. 2,000. The year she took Handspring public. 4, the number of companies she co-founded, Claris, Palm, Handspring, and Numenta. 2, broken legs. Please join me in welcoming Don Dubinsky, CEO and co-founder of Numenta, as well as former president and CEO of Palm.
Thank you.
And also, of course, co-founder and former CEO of Handspring. And now Jerry Kaplan, 37, the number of years as a tech entrepreneur. 4, the number of startups founded, 2 of which went public. 3, the number of books published. 12, the number of patents invented. And 4, the number of daughters he has. Now founder and former CEO of Go, and also fellow at the Center for Legal Informatics at Stanford University Law School. Join me in welcoming Jerry Kaplan. Next, we welcome to the stage Marc Porat. 2 months until the General Magic documentary is released. And the Computer History Museum will be screening General Magic, the documentary, later this summer. So as a fun way to introduce Marc, let's watch now a short clip.
We've got it in here.
And here's what I wrote in 1989. This is a very personal object. It must be beautiful. It must offer the kind of personal satisfaction that a fine piece of jewelry brings. It will have a perceived value even when it is not being used. It should offer the comfort of a touchstone, the tactile satisfaction of a seashell, the enchantment of a crystal. And there it is, in 1989. A little while ago, I bought an Apple iPhone 6 Plus. And there it is. We really had it. We definitely had it.
Chair and co-founder of My Right to Vote, co-founder and former CEO of General Magic, join me in welcoming Marc Porat. Now, to match this phenomenal panel, we have the best possible moderator for this evening, John Markoff. John joined the museum as historian in January. Previously, he was Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist at the New York Times, where he covered business and technology. He's also the author of books, notable books, Machines of Loving Grace, as well as What the Dormouse Said. Please join me in welcoming John Markoff, our moderator. John?
Thank you very much. Hey, everybody. Let's turn the clock back first a decade. I'm sure you all remember what it was like when Steve Jobs introduced the iPhone, because it felt like it just sprung from Zeus's head like Athena, like fully armed. Like, Jobs was such a master at marketing that he sort of reset the entire world, except nothing is ever that simple. And so today, I actually don't want to take you back 10 years. I want to take you back to the second half of the 1980s. So imagine that everybody on this panel is 3 decades younger. And we can sort of look at where the foundation for the iPhone was first laid down. And you know, now I'm a historian. I've got this new hat on. And there, among technology historians, there's this lively debate about why things happen, when, and where. And so, for example, Kevin Kelly, who's a good friend, recently wrote a book that basically argues that everything is inevitable. So that would mean that if you had flash memory, technologies like these would just simply emerge because flash came when it came. But there's another way of looking at the problem, and that's more around ideas. So, for example, think about the two guys who invented Siri, Adam Shire and Tom Gruber. They both were motivated and inspired by seeing Knowledge Navigator, and they went out to sort of build something like that. Or another example is Jerry Kaplan, for example, and Rod Brooks are two guys who went into the field of artificial intelligence and became pioneers after they saw Space Odyssey. They decided they wanted to build HAL. And so, you know, tonight we're going to talk about that sort of tension between technology and ideas and what the mix is. And you know, I don't want to go any farther without adding one caveat, and that is that there's lots and lots of prior art. This is a Silicon Valley evening. We're going to have a Silicon Valley frame of mind, but if you want sort of a bigger picture, I commend you to go downstairs and look at the mobile computing gallery that Mark Weber, who's one of the historians for the museum, has put together, and it's a really good big sweep view of all of the things you could kind of carry around when they emerged. But I wanted to deal with this group because this was a generation of technologists that largely grew up in the wake of Macintosh. You know, Macintosh came and sort of changed the world in 1984. And this is a generation of engineers and technologists who came of age in the wake of that era. We had just gotten to this particular new era of graphical computing, and already the seeds were being laid for the next generation. So, it's a long intro. If I were Tom Brokaw, I would call this the greatest Silicon Valley's greatest generation. But they were instrumental in creating the current computing era. And so I want to start by asking, what inspired you? So where did the ideas come from? And let me start with Jerry. In 1987, you were a technologist. You were the CTO at Lotus. You had just designed this program called Lotus Agenda?
Correct.
And you were on an airplane with Mitch Kapoor?
Correct.
What happened?
Well, Mitch was an inveterate note taker, and he would scribble on little pieces of paper and shove them in various pockets and then lose them. And he, at that time, was one of the first people who got a compact portable. Anybody remember this? That's the size of a suitcase. Now, you have to put this in perspective. The laptop had not been invented yet. And the fact that you could take a personal computer and carry it around, and had a battery and a flat screen and this little like lunchboxy looking thing. That was great. But he wanted to write some things down, and so he had to open it up, turn it on, boot it up, and take this thing out. And I was on a flight with him. I said, well, why don't we design a new kind of computer? And it would be a flat screen, and that you'd interact directly with the screen, and it would use static memory and, you know, sketch the basic idea.
Was a pen a part of that vision right at the start?
I don't recall, because my mind is a FIFO cue, and it's been getting shorter and shorter along with my telomeres. So I can't really tell you what, you know. I knew you were going to, but this was the result, so I might as well flash it. Especially for the people on the radio, they'll be very excited to see it.
With the battery, how much did it weigh?
I think this was 3.5-4 pounds.
Yeah.
So it's about like a heavy laptop today, but at the time, this was revolutionary, because you could hold it in one hand, and you know, you'd pop out the pen, which of course is stuck. Probably been in there for 40 years. There we go. And you would work directly on the screen. The only reason for the pen was there was no finger technology to recognize finger touch at the time.
But it got very complicated right away. And so we're also still in 1987.
Yeah.
So there was this guy by the name of Steve Sackerman, but I want to get there by asking how Steve Capps got from Macintosh, which you just finished, to doing Newton. And was Steve Sackerman part of the equation?
Well, when Jobs left Apple, we all kind of scattered to the winds. And personally, I just moved to France and wrote music software. But Bill Atkinson, who's in the audience here, we'd always been kicking around ideas of future computers. And we were alternatively jazzed by the ideas and frustrated by the technology of what was possible. One thing that should be mentioned, the computers he's talking about had lead acid batteries, you know, motorcycle batteries to power them. So, you know, it puts lithium batteries into perspective. But anyway, we had all proposed ideas. Even right after we had developed the Mac, we were talking about these things, and Bill worked on this thing called Magic Slate, and I was intrigued by ideas that Ivan Sutherland, I believe, was Sketchpad. I just thought, I'm a very visual person, and I thought, you know, having a computer that you could interact with visually and have it figure out what you meant was a very intriguing idea for me. Sackerman, I came back from Paris, I heard Sackerman was working on this project, and basically stayed up all night and handed him a white paper on what it could be, at least what I had been thinking about over the years. And, you know, he was just at this point, it was such a small project, just attracting interesting people. So we all kind of got in there. And I don't know how boring you want me to go, but Well, so he had this idea. He had named it Newton. You know, Apple had a tradition of naming him after Apple varieties, so that fit, but it also had Isaac in the background. We had a name. We had the T-shirts. We probably even had the icons, but we had no idea what we were doing. So we invented it, and I spent 6 months working on formula recognition. Who cares about handwriting recognition? I was doing two-dimensional formula recognition for a while. And that's, you know, because I'm kind of a math background. We were just wandering around, but over time we acquired companies like Paragraph for the handwriting recognition. And as you mentioned in passing, it's kind of technologically driven. The handwriting technology that was promising enough that we said, okay, we're going to go with that. And flash memory was starting to become a reality. And the ARM processor was the original I/O processor for the original Newton. We had two of the AT&T chips. We had a dual processor thing. You know, it's not like this is going to be the first handheld computer. Oh, let's put three processors in it. You know, I mean, that's the way you thought at Apple. You weren't bounded by normal gravity.
But it's kind of incestuous. I was interested in Sackerman because Sackerman had, I think, been maybe at a calculator operation that HP had, and then he passed through a project that Mitch Kapoor was running that Jerry was sort of on the edge of,
we can all speak for Mitch here, but Mitch would come to our staff meetings and partake in the Newton staff meetings, and I assume he was doing the same with you guys. Mm-hmm. So it was a little, I don't want to say incestuous, but it was... He had a lot of interesting thoughts probably running through his head. But he, you know, when he came, we welcomed him warmly, and I don't know what level Sackerman and Mitch and Jerry knew about each other.
Okay.
And I told you that one time when we thought about getting merged, and we hired a intellectual property escrow guy named Peter Miller, who kind of was, we gave him our secrets and you guys gave him his secrets, and then he would decide whether we were a good match or not without anybody having to reveal our secrets. So it was kind of a weird time.
Well, it was. Let's jump all the way now to 88. But New York City, right? Nowhere near Silicon Valley.
Manhattan.
You had touched base in Silicon Valley. It wasn't like you were coming from.
My home and my roots and was Silicon Valley. It was co-hippieing with Larry Tesler, things like that. So.
But also Stanford. Right?
And Stanford, yeah.
Yeah, but so as I you walked me through where the idea for Pocket Crystal came from, and a restaurant in Midtown. Maybe a bistro in Midtown, New York was involved.
That's true. I'd been kind of bubbling with something, and I was not able to articulate it, and I had to see it, talk about it and see it. And so this was a restaurant, and conveniently it was called Under Toi. And it was all lots of discussion and conversation. And then I scribbled, for the radio audience, thank you, Jerry, for that. I scribbled three circles that captured what I felt at the moment and what I saw at the moment. And for those of you who can't see it, which is everyone, the three circles, and this is what I walked into Apple with. This not exact piece of paper, but this. It, one is computing, one is communication, one is content, and you are at the center, the you-centric view.
And why Apple?
Apple was cool. Microsoft was recruiting me. Larry, saw that and said, no way. And I wanted to come back home to Palo Alto. Palo Alto was home. I grew up here.
Okay. But you weren't a computing guy. You were like an economist,
weren't
you?
My PhD was in economics and communication. It's called the information economy. And I, you know, so in macroeconomics, I knew that you would exist. And because I did the models, but I wanted to participate and I wanted to be part of it.
That phrase, information economy, is something you coined, is that correct?
That was my PhD, yeah.
Yeah. But so, what did you see about computing that you had this notion that...
Oh, it was absolutely the future. That's where the power and the creativity and the wonderfulness of where the civilization was going to go.
Yeah.
It was obvious, you know, now it's trite. It's trite that we used to be agricultural and then industrial and then service and now this. But at that time, it was kind of interesting. Then I made a film at the Aspen Institute called The Information Society to try and introduce the same notion of revolution and migration of power and creativity and economic engine into information. Now it's trite. Back then, it was revolutionary. And I wanted to participate and do something, not just do PhDs and movies about it. So this was it, and I came to Apple and I said, computing, everything is going to be small and in your hand and with you. Everything's going to be wireless. And content, which I didn't know about commerce at that time, but content was going to be electronic. And that's what it was going to be. And computers and Apple at that time, as you know, computers was everything. And I said, no, the future of Apple, you know, is not that. Larry sponsored me in that radical message.
This is Larry Tesler.
This is Larry Tesler, who's in the audience with us. I went around, courtesy John Sculley, to see the board members, saying to them, basically, Apple's future is not computers.
Had you known Larry Tesler from politics?
Yes, as I said, we were in politics together and stopping the Vietnam War and doing all kinds of things.
That's an interesting connection. So Donna, all this stuff is bubbling. Where did Palm's DNA come from? So there was some Apple, there was some Grid.
A little bit of everywhere, I guess. I'd been at Apple from 81 to 91, so intersecting with some of these guys and a lot of the people out there. And had left and took a year off in Paris, so Steve and I have a lot in common. And I came back and I met Jeff Hawkins, who had just started Palm very early that year. He had come from Grid, where he had done some sort of computers of that scale and had been interested in doing a smaller version, a more consumer-focused version of it. I'd come from Apple, where I'd seen, you know, an amazing generation of computing, desktop computing, take over. And when I met Jeff, and he held up, he had a little Sony palm top computer that was only in Japan at the time, and said, "This is the next generation, is handheld computing." And I, you know, I immediately got it and fell in love with the idea of being able to do computers that fit in your pocket and fit in your hand. And so I joined up with Jeff to do that.
So how about that notion of in your pocket? I mean, was that, so Jerry, you were thinking more this metaphor-wise, form factor-wise? Or? Well,
originally it was a tablet of paper was the model for what we were doing. Yeah. But by 92
was when we started Palm. Prototypes. But of course, we were thinking along the old model of what we'd learned in computing, such as Apple, where you know, there were computer companies, there was an OS, there were applications. Right. It was, you know, kind of a layered system. And so we were the application software company. That's what Palm originally was intended to be. Application software company for other people's handheld computers. And I brought mine along too. So here's our Zoomer, in case you haven't seen yours in a while. But
was this,
it was product.
It's so funny. It's much bigger than I remember.
Yeah. It's so.
We had
Jerry,
bigger pockets.
Hold yours
back
up now. Let's just see. There you go. See, it's tiny. So
mine's bigger than yours. Right?
Yeah. So this was our first project. It was the hardware was by Casio. The operating system was Geos by GeoWorks in Berkeley. And we did the application software on this device. So that was our first product, which was intended to be, you know, a handheld computer, and then was a total failure. I think we sold maybe 10,000, and there's probably 9,000 still out in the channel somewhere. And you look on eBay, you'll see them all there. And then after this, and I don't know if you want to get in it, but you know, how we kind of learned from this and figured out what to do with the Palm, which was extremely different than what we did with this device. But this was the first Palm device.
Okay, let's pause for a second and think about, you know, when. Take yourselves back to 1987, 89, to 90. What was the outside world like to you? How much was the Sharp Wizard on your guys' minds? How much was, remember Scion? How much was Scion on your minds? How much was this reinvention, and how much were you influenced by the stuff outside of the Valley? Maybe.
Well, when we would travel to Japan, we'd go to Akihabara and buy everything we could find. And since it was in Japanese, we, of course, didn't know what we were buying half the time. And the other thing, if you've ever been on a subway in Japan, if you're a gaijin, people, you know, it's a very crowded subway, but they give you space. And we would be coming back, Michael Chow and I used to always travel there together. We'd be coming back, taking everything out of the boxes so we could effectively smuggle it into the US and not pay any duty on it. So we'd be sitting in the subway with boxes, and people were stepping further and further away from us. And we'd be looking at these things, wondering what it did, and it might have been a thermostat for all we knew. But we'd come home with these things and find somebody who spoke Japanese and play with them. And the good ones you'd take apart. And again, Apple, one of the reasons Apple's so successful is because even though I haven't worked there for a long time, we're so arrogant. But we take apart a machine and we say, oh, look at this. You know, they did something goofy here. But you definitely got, you understood it. And the Wizard, we felt the Wizard was a good product. We felt that it was not designed like Apple designs products. It was a perfect form follows function, you know. There was no soul, what we would call soul in Apple, driving that product. But given the power it had and given the low processing power it had, it did a pretty amazing job for its time. But they had no architectural vision. So that's where we felt, you know, with our bigger visions, we could step in.
Yeah.
Yep.
So 1988, I'm at Apple, 1989, this thing comes, you know, pocket crystal comes around. I'm not an engineer. And when you're at Apple and you're not an engineer, you're sort of like somewhere between a worm and a single cell creature or something. You're nothing, you're zero. In fact, you're worse than, you're a negative, right? So with my non-engineering way, I needed to express what this thing was. And that's where Sharp Wizard, Steve, comes right back into the picture. My demo was a Motorola phone. Do you remember those bricks that sometimes, if it was old enough, you actually carried the battery with you? Remember that thing? So it was that, because that's what I had. That was my innovation. And a sharp wizard, and basically duct tape. That was the model of the magic machine.
Yeah.
The pocket crystal was that. And when I ran around with it thinking that was such an expressive, wonderful thing, engineers would look at me like I was completely psycho, until some of them actually said, we're doing it. And that was the prototype.
Yeah, I just thought that wizard was a very important product, and I think we looked at the wizard a lot. And I think the main thing we got out of it was the application. The fact was people use that for contacts, address book, phone numbers, things like that. And it showed the utility of that application. Yes, we agreed it could do it a lot more elegantly with a lot more fun things as a part of it. But that core functionality is what was absolutely core on the Zoomer, became core on the Palm Pilot, was the organizer piece of it. In fact, when we created the Palm Pilot, we decided to call it a connected organizer. We wanted to build on the wizard heritage and say what's different about it is it connects to your PC. But it's like an organizer in that it organizes your life, your calendar, and your contacts. So that was a very important product. The other important product to mention besides Scion, which was a set of important products, was the HP 100LX, which in our view was one of the leading products in the space at the time as well.
But nobody mentioned Scion.
Yeah, Scion was, Scion was very interesting product. They did a much better job on user interface and elegance than the Japanese companies did. So they had a very nice looking product. But, you know, none of those products had real development environments and platforms and an ability to add applications to them. So they were all kind of dead end products in their way. And so there was a big leap forward with these next generation of products that were all platform products.
Jerry, had you tried to put a agenda on anything else before you decided to build? I mean, you know, rather than a portable computer, had you tried to put it on any appliance?
The answer is no. But for the audience, Lotus Agenda was the first personal information manager, or one of the first. I just have to be careful when I say things like that. I'll get my email will be filled up tomorrow.
Yeah.
No, I had one just before you did. And they're right. There's no beginning. It's all a giant circle. But the idea was to be able to organize personal information and then to be able to communicate that out. But I want to agree with Steve Capps on this. It was really all, what we were totally focused on was the interface. It was all about the conviction that we needed a new interface and a new operating system to take advantage of the unique characteristics of this new class of device.
God, that was a long time ago. Our center was communication. That was very, very important to us in content. And I still have a suspicion to this day that our team, particularly Andy Hertzfeld, who's also in the audience, wanted to build a Mac 3. That's really what, there was a very strong sense of Apple design sensibility, of beauty, which is why we did the hardware, Donna, as well as the software. And quite frankly, that's why it was such a closed system. It was going to be gorgeous. And they succeeded, the engineers succeeded. It was gorgeous. And some of the applications that you see today and use today are really, you can see them inside that magic machine in 1990. And by the way, there are two magics. There are two general magics, and one of them is the operating system and the product. But the one that I think is the enduring one is the people who created that magic. And I just wanted to say that there are some giants sitting in the audience. And if you're from General Magic, could you just stand up or clap or say something? Just stand up and say hi.
Oh yeah, there we go. Whoa.
Yeah.
So who's here from Go?
Yeah. Let's see, we're stand up guys. There we are.
And Palm?
Same people.
and Newton. Who's here from Newton? Is anybody here from all four? There is someone. That's great.
All four. Wow.
So, does anybody know where the phrase personal digital assistant came from?
I believe it's Apple's PR.
Yeah, it was.
Somebody would be able to tell us who, but I believe it's somebody working for PR fed it to John at CES 91 or two.
Sort of top down.
Yeah.
It was top down. So
that's it, that has stuck. It, you know, people do it has, still.
Yeah. And but I want to. So did, let me put it simply. Did Scully blow it? Here you had this explosion. Well,
on, which time?
Poor John.
Oh.
I don't mean it that way. But in retrospect, there was this, and Jerry's term, a Cambrian explosion of devices. There was just so much stuff going on coming from different directions, and there was so much stuff going on coming just from Apple. I mean, we haven't mentioned projects like Swatch and Rolex that were, you know, were stillborn, I guess is the right way to put it politely. But what if Scully had sort of forced everything together rather than pushing it apart? Would there have been a different outcome? You said that you talked about that. So that.
Yeah, well, to be a little historical here, John at that time, and I don't think he blew it at all. I think he had too many opportunities, actually. He was very supportive of General Magic to the point where I would question him because I'd be at Bill's house at night talking about General Magic and then spend my day with Sackerman talking about Newton. And I went to John and said, pick one. You know, I can't deal with the, you know, this schizophrenic life here. And then Paul Mercer came along later with yet another option.
Who's also in the audience?
And so I think the problem was we were all dressed up and the technology just wasn't there enough to support our dreams. So we were all kind of destined to fail because we had gotten a little too close to the sun. And then of course technology made it so it was possible to be that far. And that's when things have really worked. And I think Donna looked at the technology and Jeff looked at the technology and said, what's the minimal shippable product that we can do with this technology? And they delivered it. And I'm sure we arrogantly said, oh, that's just, you know, simple organizer. But she by far was the most successful one sitting up here. So.
Well, yay, palm people. I think it's really important to understand what Palm did that was different that made it successful, because it wasn't just the technology components coming together, maturing, or things like that. It was a very different design center. All these other devices, and our prior one, Zoomer as well, was a computer that you were trying to make small and do different things, but it was fundamentally a standalone computer. The Palm Pilot, I have one of them here as well. The Palm Pilot was really designed as an accessory to a computer, not as a standalone computer. And that totally changed the dynamic of what it was and what it had to do. For example, all these things had printer drivers in them. You had to write them, you had to include them, you had to debug them, there was so much complexity in that. This thing never printed. I mean, today you look at it, you say, of course it doesn't, but you know, at the time that was really radical. It synchronized automatically with a PC. It was like a mirror onto your PC as opposed to a standalone device. And that was that design twist in thinking, having things built around synchronization, made it very buildable. So it wasn't so much, oh, the hardware got better or whatever. It was a very different design center.
Yeah. Jerry?
I just wanted to defend John Scully for a second. It's extremely hard to know which projects are going to be successful or how the ecosystems are going to develop, or whether making it an accessory to, insisting that you also have a PC would be a good business decision or a bad business decision. These things are extremely difficult to predict. There's a tremendous amount of randomness. And with all the various threads and devices that were exploding at the time, I don't think, you can't say, well, he blew it, or he made a mistake, or him or anybody else. It's very difficult.
So Andy would say it's Steve Capps' fault, the whole thing, because if this is legend, so I don't even know if it's true, but if he had been able to recruit you, personally, you, and it's not just generally speaking the Newton team, but you, history, into General Magic, then General Magic would have like been the iPhone of the world. So is there
great
a cost?
Man theory of history.
The great man theory. So is there a cost to redundant competitive projects? There's a cost, but also, you know, Jerry, I agree with you. The thing that part by itself was not a bad thing. I think some of the artifacts was the same time, you know, John was sitting on our board and sitting on, essentially, I mean, basically the chairman of Newton, obviously. And it was, I have to confess, I'm sure it was difficult for him, but it was very difficult for us.
Yeah.
We just never knew what was going on. And we were competitive, but not really. There's a lot of love between the individuals, a lot of love and respect between the individuals. It's just like we were living in two different camps that didn't serve either one particularly well in retrospect.
Yeah. But it's still, the other thing that, you know, is striking, if you look at these four companies, the diaspora that came from the collapse. I mean, the one thing that I've heard, tell me if this is true, that Tony Fadell and Andy Rubin sat back to back or adjacent to each other in a cubicle.
Not back to back, but let's say from there to there. And Tony was, when he was sitting, he wasn't sitting all the time because he was kind of like very energetic and shooting Nerf balls and breaking windows and things like that. But when they were sitting, they were there. And so there you had Tony, and
the guy who
there you had Andy,
original and hardware, and the guy who for iPhone, and the guy who led.
You have Android, and you have you know it's sort of
all in one space. But there were
amazing.
There were 10 other people who.
There were
the 30, CTO of the United States happened to be at General.
There were 30 other people. I don't know what the number is, but an extraordinary. That's what I meant when I said that the other product of General Magic is the magicians and the spirit that they created. That unbelievable. For me personally, it was a peak experience in my life, and others have said that to me, who've since gone on to do great things. Yeah, so Megan was our child. Megan Smith was our child. She's now the CTO, and John Ginandrea was a good solid engineer, working with us, and now he's running a big chunk of Google, obviously, and it goes on and on and on. It goes on and on.
So at the same time, now that we've gone after John Sculley, my understanding is that Steve Jobs didn't get it initially. Does anybody want to sort of speak to Steve coming to the notion of computing in your hand? It took a while.
Are you setting me up for that story I told you yesterday?
I was giving you the opportunity to.
Let's go back a little further. Bill Atkinson, of course, Steve looked to him for a lot of inspiration. And Bill definitely, I'm sure, talked about this project called Magic Slate back in 85, Bill? 84, 85. And I'm sure through General Magic, he probably kept him apprised of what was going on.
Yeah, definitely.
So he knew it, but then he inherited a company that had one, AKA Newton. And I think, it didn't fit in his model. He probably spent 2 minutes trying it one day and in typical style, I won't say it for radio audience, but he probably disparaged it. But I think there was a lot of good ideas there and a lot of good people there. And the main hardware designer of Newton became his main hardware designer of the iPhone. The guy I hired to take my place designing the UI for Newton became the main UI guy for iPhone. Yeah. So whether or not he would admit it, he got a lot of influence from the Newton crowd, just kind of like what Mark was saying with the magic magicians. And my joke on the statistics was, I've been deposed so many times to defend patents from the Newton era that they're using to fight Samsung. So I know they have some respect for it.
Yeah. Well, so maybe I'll flip that. Maybe Jobs' real genius, aside from marketing, is timing. Mm-hmm. Maybe that's what he's done right over a long
time. I think he assembles the right crowd of people and keeps the pot stirred, and then maybe take credit for it.
Can I tell? I'll tell you a quick Steve story. Is that we met with him when Palm was being very successful, and we met with Steve, and he drew a picture on the whiteboard of the computer in the middle, and then lots of little devices hanging off of it. And that was his vision. And you could see, this was at the time where the iPod was there. And so, there was a notion of that hub. And Jeff Hawkins, my partner, drew a picture of the handheld as the center of the universe with, all the other devices around. And so at that time, Steve was definitely not of a mind yet of seeing the handheld as anything, central in the computing universe.
Yeah.
So this was well before the iPhone, and he had other priorities.
So the other thing he sort of brought over the hump was Siri and this kind of conversational interface. But you guys all, well, maybe not all of you, but didn't you all sort of take cuts at, I mean, Newton had an assistance feature. You guys were doing rule, what did General Magic do that was sort of assistant-like?
It was a really important, and half the company was doing TeleScript. Which was the language, the interpreter language before, you know, before Java. It was basically, that's what it was for. That was a language of agents. Rich Miller and Jim White brought it to us. He's in the audience. Brought it to us, and we said, that's what we need. Remember, we were in a mindset where there was no TCP/IP. There was no, I mean, there was, but not in broad use at all. And pre-internet, in every sense of the word. It was pre-internet. I remember actually a story that I can't get corroborated, but I believe it to be true, which is Mosaic came to us one day, early on, and there was a lot of excitement around it, and we put it up, and it was kind of like black and white, and it crashed in 30 seconds, and that was the last time we were interested in that for a few months. I mean, it was really, really early, but agent technology was what we spoke about. I mean, a lot of the narrative and a lot of the kind of the magic of it all was saying that each of us, each person, can be represented out there in the world by assistants. Kind of the democratization of having an assistant. And that was the story. And we would tell stories about how agents would be created and how they would park themselves on what is, you know, servers essentially, and do things for you when you're not around because the internet, the network, is on 24/7 and you're not and you don't want to be. So you need representatives. It became a very intimate story of how you were able to connect with the world. So yes, agent technology was a big part of our story. It was not the big part of what we ended up shipping, because it's hard. It was really hard to do, but it was a very, very important part of the vision, for sure.
And it was at the heart of Newton, wasn't it?
Yeah, Newton, we originally wanted to ship, if you think about it, apps. There was one app called the Notepad, and you would write what you thought. If you wrote a name down on it, we would recognize it was a name, and we would organize it for you. Then we started doing user tests, and users didn't particularly like that. Whereas we might have been kind of freeform in our thinking, users liked to go to a place to enter names or liked to go to a place to enter dates. But a lot of that still lived in the fact that you could write lunch, you know, the infamous lunch with Bob next Tuesday, and we understood what you meant, if we recognized it correctly. we understood what you meant and would pop up a dialog box that says, would you like me to put this in the calendar? Even though it stayed in your notepad. And that's kind of that was our soul that drove us for a long time. And then, like I said, we tempered that with user tests where we then built the classic apps. But yeah, when I get frustrated with Siri, it just brings back all my memories of getting frustrated with handwriting recognition.
But it's worth pointing out, graffiti was the exact opposite approach of Apple. Very much like the example I used earlier, that we took this connected organizer approach as opposed to a small computer approach with handwriting recognition. We said, we just don't think we can do it. And users don't like to be surprised. They want to control the device, not have the device control them. They want to know what they're going to put into it, they're going to get out of it. So our metaphor was a typing metaphor, which was users learn to type. They have to put in some learning time, but then it does exactly, if they do it right, it gives them exactly what they want. And graffiti was really patterned after typing. It was like typing with a stylus. And if you learned the little alphabet, which I'm sure a lot of you out there did, and you could learn it quite quickly, it would be highly reliable and do what you wanted it to do.
You put it in the user's court, basically.
Yeah, I got to tell, Michael
Chow. Instead of having the machine adjust to you, you adjusted to the machine.
Well, Michael Chow's version of this is really a great story, which is Newton said, oh, we're going to let you write the way you write, so when it's screwed up, you blame the machine. These guys said, you're going to have to learn a new way of interacting with the machine, so when it's screwed up, you blamed yourself. That is a secret to marketing success.
A million units in 18 months.
Yeah.
So, Jerry, where did Go fit in? Where did Go fit into this? In terms of, did you do things that were sort of intelligent interface things? And how far did you guys get with Penn?
God, yes. I mean, there was all kinds of interconnectivity. It was an object-oriented operating system. There was a notebook, organizing metaphor of a notebook. I think probably the biggest innovation in that, which is now completely widespread, is what we call gestures. which is basically the idea that you could do certain kinds of things on the screen directly. At that time, scratch things out or drag things around. Now I think this is so natural. But that was probably the single greatest achievement in that.
And did you have an assistant idea? I mean, was there?
Well, you could highlight things and it would go onto your calendar or go here or go there. So there's an interconnectivity. There was an index in the notebook that you could go to and find things. So we didn't explicitly think of it as an agent in the sense that Mark was just talking about, but it was a highly interconnected. You could embed one application into another. You could put a drawing into a document. That was new at the time. I mean, these are things you take for granted today, but you could stretch things and blow them up. You could do all of these great things. One of the innovations that at the time was great, you could hold it vertically, or you could turn it portrait or landscape mode, and it would, you'd be able to shift it.
Did you patent that?
I don't think we did that one. I don't think
Radius did it first, yeah.
It's in some sense, the concept of intelligent agent is one of those things that's always, it's always 3 years away. It will always be 3 years away because you can endow intelligence into an experience that just is endless until you get to, obviously, where it's going to go. It's, artificial intelligence where it's not recognizable. I had this amazing, sort of really interesting conversation with Vint Cerf, who was actually my first boss. My first ever boss was Vint. And when we started talking about intelligent agents and what, Google and other companies are doing in that domain to get to know you personally, and talking about sort of concepts like the companies who are involved in agent-like technology need to be at the frontier of creepiness, minus epsilon.
Yeah.
Because creepiness minus epsilon is where you get the greatest value from having agent technology do things for you and represent you. If it doesn't know anything about you, it can't add value. If it knows too much, totally creepy. And then that gets you into the laws of robotics. What can an agent do on your behalf? And we were talking about that in 1994. What can you endow an agent, for example, with representing who you are, such that it can park on a server and spend money on your behalf when you're not there? Can an agent meet another agent and negotiate? And can they make a deal of some sort and come back to each of their masters and so on? Can you kill an agent? How do you kill an agent? How do you know that the agent's dead? What happens if two agents get together and have babies? and start creating agents that are themselves empowering each other because the code went nuts. We were actually talking about those exact edge case scenarios, use case. Now, let me contrast that, by the way, with what Donna was saying. The practical, simple thing that worked and worked commercially. Yeah. Now, juxtapose that next to this incredible permanent dream of where, in fact, the industry is going. One is inspired, not that the other one isn't. It's very inspiring to sell a million machines. There's nothing wrong with that. But one is a kind of an inspiration that leads creative engineers to go completely working 24/7. Yeah. That's what they do because they all saw it. And just to finish, actually, I saw my role as CEO is to just hold that vision, that kind of, for example, the intelligent agent vision, clearly, speak about it clearly, and don't bother the engineers. Let them go to it. And that was both the success and I think the failure of General Magic was the enormity of that vision.
So we've gotten through 50 minutes, and I think it's my fault we haven't mentioned Microsoft.
Oh, them. I mentioned it.
So was Microsoft always a follower? How much were they on your radar? Jerry, you got entangled with them, but...
Well, yeah. I mean, there was famously, they were trying to exclude us from the marketplace, as you know. But there were a lot of excellent people there, and it doesn't reflect on the company today. So I'm not sure what.
Well, I was trying to think about where Microsoft was in terms of the innovation.
Well, Microsoft's goal at that time was very clear. It was to build a moat around their operating system. It was to protect the monopoly. So anything that protected the monopoly, if that meant investing in new technology, either to use it or to kill it, that was their approach. It was a good business approach, and it worked.
They had access to at a certain point to Xerox Tech Park technology that came through DEC. and then ended up in this group in Silicon Valley that Chuck Thacker was involved in. They did their own hardware.
They wanted Windows. They wanted
Windows
the Mac.
Everywhere.
It was all
that was the battle.
CE. It was shrinking down Windows, and it really was the wrong place to start to do a handheld OS. But they just insisted it had to be Windows compatible. That was their number one goal was Windows compatibility. A great device or a useful device wasn't as high a goal as Windows compatibility. So that's what they got.
So two stories. Story one is that Nathan Merville totally got it. Absolutely, totally got it. We were in a lot of discussions about agent technology. He saw the whole thing. I mean, profoundly saw it. And I learned from him because we were negotiating and talking about things. And the other was a roundtable dinner with Bezos and Gates and so on. He looked at me like I was complete. He said, the whole thing, what you're talking about, is stupid. And that was our conversation. And I think he was condemning the entire field of these little intelligent things at that time. It was just ridiculous. It was consumer technology that was like stupid. Yeah.
Well, I think I have a rare experience of working for both Steve Jobs and Bill Gates. So my experience with Bill Gates, going back to circle to the John Scully comment, is Bill Gates likes to have competing groups and likes to have projects fully funded, fully operational, fully staffed, competing against each other, because he was a complete evolutionist. He would say whichever one wins is the product we'll go with. And I would, all my time there, I kept on pleading with him to choose the project I was working on or choose the one that we were competing with. And so I actually don't think anything was really thought out there. It was just, they were throwing out a bunch of ideas and they were seeing which ones stuck. There wasn't that much innovation in that, because I was hired to work in the handheld stuff in late 90s, so it's a little bit later. And there was definitely none of the, as Mark would say, the dreaming that Andy and Bill and I would go off and do. It was more practical, and then they'd get five groups to go off and do five variations of it and see which one wins. So I don't think they really ever even factored in our radar that much in Newtonland.
Jerry.
I was defending John Scully. Let me defend Bill Gates. I mean, Bill was he's a terrific technologist, and he really, I think this story notwithstanding, he understood this stuff and he loved it. And he empowered a lot of people inside his organization to work on a lot of things. It just wasn't in their business interest necessarily to pursue it. And that takes, in its own way, a certain kind of vision. I don't happen to like that or agree with it. But, he was capable of seeing how this did or did not fit into that. But if I could slightly change the subject, John, before you turn it over for questions. There are a couple of people that were really heavily involved in this area. We've mentioned a lot of them, but I'd like to take a moment to acknowledge some of our fallen heroes. Mike Homer, who was at Apple and at Go, was instrumental in a lot of this technology and in tutoring, really, John Scully on that. Bill Campbell, who was also at Apple and Go. They're no longer with us, but you guys, how many people remember them and worked with them? Hey, there we go. Okay.
Along those lines, I think tribute should be paid to Mike Colbert, who was the, we stole him out of Cornell to work, become the hardware engineer for Newton, but he came up with this term called MIPS per watt. And at this point, the biggest power consumption of a device was the screen and the processor. And he took, like I said earlier, the I/O processor from this over-designed original Newton and convinced Larry Tesler, who's in the audience, that this company was about to fail that made this really efficient chip. And so Larry convinced John to invest the $2.5 million that was on my slide that I guarantee you every one of you has one, at least one in your pocket right now.
And revenge of risk.
The ARM chip has just probably been the most revolutionary thing, pervasively revolutionary thing, that even compared to our products here. I think that it will continue to be that for another decade, probably.
There's an incredible little video that on YouTube that you can find of Andy Hertzfeld and Zarko Dragonic holding a magic device with a tether to a motherboard, big motherboard. But the UI was almost exactly iOS, almost exactly. And you know, they're saying, and Zarco is one of the most gentle, lovely human beings on the planet, who's no longer with us, was saying this is going to be the thing. This is the telephone of the future, or something to that effect. And so, and one other, the Susan Cares logo, the rabbit, that everyone remembers.
Susan here?
Exactly. I don't know if she's here in the audience, but that thing is one of the other most famous things that resulted is that cheerful little rabbit saying, hello. Phil Goldman, who's no longer with us, was her husband, and they met at General Magic.
So, you know, the personal computer industry was so driven by the original vision of the Dynabook. I mean, you know, it sort of was an organizing principle. You know, Park had a similar sort of organizing idea in ubiquitous computing, I think, in the second half of the 80s, which you guys all implemented, but the vision wasn't as strong. They had inside Park, Mark Weiser had tabs and pads and boards. He had these metaphors, but it had much less of an impact on the world. I mean, they made a Scientific American article that brought it all out to the world. Was ubiquitous. I mean, they were kind of right. You did what they sort of argued for, that is, that ubiquitous computing was the computer disappears and everyday objects become magic, which is sort of what happened as a result of your work. But the idea didn't have the same force?
You actually got to keep going further. They got the internet, Ethernet. They had a product called Unistroke, which is essentially graffiti. Yep. Not a product. Excuse me. Xerox and the word product is an oxymoron.
It's a long history on that one as well.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, there's nothing. Probably everybody in this room has been affected by work done at Park. You may or may not know it. And again, they were, like I said about our generations of products, except for Donna's, we were ahead of the technological curve, and Xerox was way ahead of the technological curve. That's true. So I do think, you know, we have to acknowledge that, and I'm sure it affected us. And we all had the Xerox Blue Books, if you remember what those were, and you would pore over them. Xerox Blue Books were their public disclosure of they would describe the Alto computer in a famous Blue Book, which was actually black, but they called them the Blue Books. But there would be a Blue Book about the Ethernet and a Blue Book about.
Actually, it's a story I should tell at this point because it's anecdotal, but I believe it to be true because I heard it from a Xerox engineer. You know, Xerox had all the IP for LCDs at a certain point, and they were about to enforce their intellectual property, and the Justice Department came after them on copiers. And it, as a public relations move to not seem like bad guys, they decided not to go ahead and enforce the IP, which is why the flat panel world flourished. Does anybody heard this story? I believe it to be true. Correct me if I'm not.
False news, John.
Unnamed
sources? Did I get that right?
Yeah, what are my sources? I'm just throwing it out there in the hopes that I can verify. So let's turn to the audience. What could General Magic or Handspring have done to be in the position that Apple is in today in the smartphone market? What did you do wrong, I guess?
What should we have done? Yeah. Well, a lot of things. We had too many IQ points in one space, one room. We were just bubbling over with IQ points. We should have hired less people who were less smart and told them to go home at 5 o'clock. No, actually, we couldn't have done it. The vision was larger than the capacity to do it, and it was way ahead of its time, and that's clear. I mean, that's absolutely the story of General Magic is it was like 10 years ahead of its time. In every sense of the word, and it was the best place. It was the magical place for engineers to work. But that doesn't get you a product, and that doesn't get you to ship. And we were 3 years late on shipping the OS, and so on. So we underachieved on the real business goals, and we overachieved on the spirit and the, you know, of it all. That's one thing. Second thing is our business model was to create the global standard. So whereas Apple did it in a proprietary way, Microsoft did it in its way, which we thought was, you know, was the right way to go. the Microsoft method. So, you know, so in some sense. So what we did was we licensed, I think you probably know the story, most of you, licensed our technology, and that's how we got funded to 16 really large consumer electronics and computing and telecommunications companies who then created a kind of a monument, who owned the market. Sony, Matsushita, Philips is one example. And that created a monumental decision gridlock and torn objectives, all of which we had to compartmentalize as secrets, one from the other. It was Newton General Magic Time 16 that we had to manage. And these are big guys who are very jealous of each other, who all wanted the standard to be theirs, essentially.
Yeah, you know, it was really hard all those years. I mean, there were so many technical things that were hard that you just had to get just right, where you were right on the edge of things being able to work together. And I think we did pretty darn well on a lot of that stuff and came through. I mean, I brought Trios along as well. So we had, you know, the very early smartphones that, you know, some of the first successful smartphones. Yes, thank you. And you know, we ended up really struggling with some major business-related issues, I would say, more than on the product side, and made a few bad mistakes, had a few bad mistakes made to us that, you know, combined created very difficult conditions for us. We ended up not being able to fund Palm. We got acquired by US Robotics, subsequently got acquired by 3Com. That was a very complex set of transactions. Ended up in an environment that wasn't a great fit for us, so we left, and you know, 3Com, we started Handspring, and then Handspring was really a rocket ship. That was the most amazing company. People think of Palm most often, but Handspring was at one point the fastest growth company in American business history. I mean, it really was an extraordinary success story. And we were accelerating into just tremendous volumes when the recession hit, and you know, very big kind of financial collapse. And we had unfortunately just signed a big lease for a big new building, so that hurt us financially terribly. So that was a very bad decision that we made that came back to bite us. But when we then joined back up with Palm, so all these, every time you did one of these combinations, recombinations, spin-offs, leaving, coming back together, you lose a year, 2 years in the process. So if we hadn't had to go through all of those disruptive events, I think, you know, we would have fared much better in the long run. So I'd say it was really the business disruption over all those ins and outs of corporate things that ended up getting in our way.
So this is good. This is a question asked by a group of people. I'm going to ask it my way. We're going to look forward for just a second at least. You know, I walk down the street in San Francisco, and fully half the people are staring at the palm of their hand as they walk down the street. This cannot be the end of user interface history. So the question is, what role do you think the smartphone will play in AR and VR? So what's some guesses on where things might go beyond this?
I'll let the engineers take that one.
Pocket crystal. What's after the pocket crystal? Jerry?
Well, I don't think the phone is the end of the line. We've always thought that with the mini computer, the micro computer, the personal computer. I can really envision a whole new suite of hardware. It's basically hardware driven. It's going to change the utility of these things around what I would loosely, today's called slightly misleadingly, augmented reality. I think that the next class of interfaces, you know my point of view on this, John, are going to be audio and oral interfaces where you'll wear a little thing that looks like a hearing aid, and it will be helping you, directing you, and possibly overlays of what you can see in some unobtrusive way. So the idea that you're staring down at a phone is going to seem very antiquated probably in another 10 to 15 years.
If you recall, it's maybe you don't recall, but people, when they first got cell phones, used to go into phone booths, if you remember what phone booths are, to use
That's
them.
Where I used to change my clothes.
So, and we used to think it was quaint that, you know, it was kind of embarrassing to talk in public. Mm-hmm. And then when those Bluetooth things first started, you know, it used to be when you saw somebody walking down the street talking to themselves, you went to the other sidewalk. And now it's considered normal, and the same thing's going to happen. We're going to look back at this and say, really? You had to stare at the screen and you tripped on the curb? You know, you got hit by a car? How quaint.
I don't have a comment on that, but I do want to ask, there are some incredible mathematicians in the audience. I want you to estimate, since the beginning of the iPhone, let's say, launch, how many trillions of hours have been consumed staring at phones worldwide? Anybody can do that math in their head? Just run the curve of shipments times the number of hours you think people are doing it, times the demand out there in the embedded base. Anybody have a number? 2 trillion. Anybody else have a number? Okay, so we'll go with 2 trillion because that's the only number we have. That's it? All the mathematicians, we get one number out of it? Okay, so let's say it's 2 trillion. And can you imagine? Can you imagine that much time and the value of that much time? And by next year, it'll be 4 trillion. If 2 is correct, next year it'll be 4.
And how much of it was Candy Crush?
80%.
Or 140 characters.
Yeah.
So just in terms of just sheer economic activity and human activity, just staggering.
Yeah. So this is another sort of along those lines. What concepts in personal computing that didn't catch on do you think still have potential? So what's out there that hasn't made it to the next wave? I guess from the last wave,
I'm actually always been disappointed about the app centricity of the iPhone. I wished it didn't look like a little desktop. And eventually somebody will break through that. Maybe it'll be with augmented reality or something. But I certainly hope we're not, putting on glasses and putting something in our ear and double-clicking an icon, or thinking about double-clicking icons 10 years from now. But sadly, I'm afraid we're going to be, because the economics of the app ecosystem are just too strong for it to overcome that.
Why do you think large companies like Microsoft, HP, and Intel missed this market so completely? Is that fair? Did they?
Well, when you're successful, it's hard to not to eat your young, as we used to say.
Well, there's a great book by Clay Christensen called Innovator's Dilemma, and that was a little bit our Bible, which is that companies tend to want to listen to customers, that makes sense, so they do incremental versions of what they're doing to feed what customers want next in features, and they also tend to want to go uphill. They want to get more expensive products, more upstream, and these products at the end of the day were lower cost, and it's very hard for companies to do that. I mean, we found all sorts of examples like this. Like, we did an OEM deal on the Palm Pilot with IBM, and we were so excited IBM was going to sell the Palm Pilot. How cool is that? Well, IBM sales reps, they were going in, they were trying to sell big machines, and they really didn't care about this $299 thing. They used it like a party favor. You know, they'd leave one with the guy they were calling on as a gift, you know? And they never got serious about selling it because it was so low cost. So I think it was very, very hard for those companies with more expensive devices and the desire to put more and more into them and meet features to go under that. And I consider reading Clay's book because it does a great job of describing that phenomenon.
Jerry?
I think one main reason that large companies are not typically very good at innovating is that the projects need to be, to get approved, they have to be disseminated and studied throughout the organization. And you need to have objective evidence that it's going to work, or ways of measuring or reducing into the types of tools that you use, spreadsheets and PowerPoint presentations, facts that people can rely upon in order to back up making the decision to go with it. But the reason that these things came about that we're talking about on the panel is that we didn't need to do that in a small company. You had a vision, people shared it, and you didn't have to convince 5 layers of management to that it somehow fit into their business model.
Yeah. So this one kind of recapitulates what Mark just said, but I have to ask it to give you guys another chance. Were we better off as social animals back before the iPhone? Has the PC in our pocket hurt our quality of life? What do you think?
Me?
Yeah.
Absolutely not. First, no. I'm convinced that this technology, these technologies that are all conflated as one experience, which includes the cloud. I mean, it's sort of, at the end of the day, it's your little picture, or it's all connected. And the cloud is as much part of it as anything. That has an infinite future. infinite in a, sort of a, in a bounded sense. But, but it has an incredible future, because where can that go? It can go absolutely everywhere. And so the technology of iPhones or the technology of handhelds is unlocked that key to simply putting us into a world that I don't think we can imagine. I do remember someone saying, Steve, to your point, all the apps that have ever been needed have been created, and there's no point doing any more apps. That was only 10 years ago.
Before Uber.
So we don't know the combinations and permutations of people's creativity.
I think there's always a fear and a tendency to look at technology as, there's the bad side. And there are bad sides of a lot of technologies. I mean, cars have car accidents, but, cars also make, the world much more accessible to you as well. And I personally think these devices have just done a tremendous, tremendous opening of the world for all of us. To have all the information in the world at your fingertips is just, extraordinary. We take it for granted now, but the ability to know where you are, to know how to get to something, to look up a piece of work that you see on the wall of a museum and learn more about the artist, just the richness that it's given us, the ability to communicate with each other, I think it's just been a phenomenal amount of positive.
On the other hand, we don't have the right to turn off Trump's Twitter account. So as much as his own staff would like him to do that.
I was going to go in that direction.
We made it 2 hours without Trump. No, right.
So we're at 8:15. I'm going to invite Marguerite up in a second to conclude the evening, but I wanted to give Steve Capps the floor just briefly to make a personal request.
If you've ever worked with me, you know I have a tendency not to ask for help. Today I met with a transplant team because my daughter needs a bone marrow transplant. I'm sorry I'm breaking up a little bit here. Unfortunately, we're all a little too old for this because you really want young bone marrow. But go home and get your kids to register at bethematch.org. And you're not going to help my daughter. There's 50 strangers in the world, approximately 50 to 100 we found out today, that are potential matches for her. If we can each get 10 people to sign up, and over the next 20 years, the chances are none of them are going to be a match for anybody. But let's go back to mathematicians. It's just worth taking 5 minutes to do a cheek swab and sending it in. And I did this many years ago. You get a nice string of emails every few months with a heart-rendering story. Anyway, it's just one of these karmic things that everybody here, we're so lucky to be working in the Valley over the last few decades that we get so used to it. And so just, and we've been very lucky to influence a lot of people, but this is a way to really influence the life of one person. So, thank you.
So let me end where we began. I really do believe that this was Silicon Valley's, this is Silicon Valley's greatest generation. So let's please give them a hand.
Oh, thank you.
Marguerite.
I want to join John in thanking all of our speakers and special thoughts to you, Steve, with your daughter.
Thank you.
As we close tonight's program, I'm really delighted to let you know that this is not the end, but the beginning of a discussion here about computing in your pocket here at the Computer History Museum. This is kicking off a new project, iPhone 360, which will be led here by the Exponential Center. These 360 projects take a deep dive into transformational companies or products that really have changed our world through combining technology, innovation, economic value creation, and social impact, as our panelists have talked tonight. On June 27, 2007, Steve Jobs launched iPhone 9 years and 1 month later to the day. Apple celebrated the sale of the billionth iPhone, truly an exponential story. And during the past decade, iPhone has made history, not just to put computing in your pocket, but to pioneer new business models, universal software apps, the global supply chain, and many other things. It's become a powerful tool as well as a constant companion. and ways both positive and sometimes challenging, it's changed the daily lives of literally billions of people around the world. So iPhone 360, this project, explores the depth and impact of this revolution. And the project team, many of them are here tonight, I ask you to stand, includes our curators here at the museum as well as other experts. And we're working together with people like these who are really the first person creators as well as users to explore the phenomenon of iPhone, its how it came to be, its impact and implications, as well as what it means for not only the past, but the present and maybe looking into the future. So during this coming year with iPhone 360, there'll be additional events, new research and insights that you can use, collections that we hope to add to the to our collection. These look pretty good.
You've got plenty in mind.
You got it.
As well as new education content. So have you been part of this revolution? Yes. We are inviting you, if you have relevant artifacts or parts of the story to tell, help us capture and tell this transformational story. We want to hear from you. Contact me or members of the team. Join us in helping tell this story and telling it right. So thank you again to our panelists tonight, and good night.
Thank you.